Hello and welcome to this video about your iron marker blood tests. This is part of a series of videos where we break down all your organ systems. If you want to find out about other ones, check out the playlist. Otherwise, let's get into your iron status. As always, if you've had a blood test and your markers are all over the place, go see your doctor. Otherwise, let's get into it. This is looking at how much iron is in your body. And iron is a really, really important mineral for you to have. It's very important for oxygen, for example, and how that gets transported around the body in your red blood cells. So if you look at our red blood cell full blood count video, you'll see these two videos overlap a little bit. So there are actually two kind of different types of iron. There's one that's bound to proteins, which you can absorb really easily. And there's another one which is oxidized, which your body has to break down in order to absorb it more easily. Now, the easily absorbed iron, which is Fe2+, that comes predominantly from things like meats. Fe3+, the one that we need to break down, is found in a lot of vegetables. So your body needs to work a little bit harder to translate that iron into one which can be absorbed. So if you're a vegetarian or a vegan, it's slightly harder for you to get the iron into your body than if you ate meats. It should still be possible, but you just got to have that in the back of your mind so you're making sure you've got iron in your diet. When we look at the iron blood test, we're looking at four main markers: serum iron, TIBC or total iron binding capacity, transferrin saturation and ferritin. So let's start with serum iron. Well, serum iron is just the general measure of iron in your blood. It's not a fantastic measure because it goes up or down really easily depending on what you've just eaten. So to put that into context, we look at the other things as well. Now, total iron binding capacity is how well your red blood cells are going to be able to bind that iron and how much capacity they have to do so. If you don't have very much iron in your body, then the total iron binding capacity is pretty high. If you have too much iron, TIBC is a little bit low. That's almost the opposite from when we look at transferrin saturation. So that's how much the protein in those red blood cells is saturated by the iron. So if you have way too much iron in your diet, then transferrin saturation goes up. And if you are iron deficient, your transferrin saturation is way down low. Finally, we have ferritin, and ferritin is the general measure of iron stores. It's looking at how much of that broken down iron you have in your body. Now, putting all these together and putting them alongside each other lets us see what kind of picture we're getting for you. So, if you are iron deficient, which can happen in people who are not getting enough iron in their diet, or in people who are bleeding. So for example, if you have heavy periods, if you've got some bowel upset and there's some blood coming out, or if a shark bites your arm off and you lose a load of blood that way, then you'll probably be iron deficient because you've lost a lot of red blood cells. So if that is the case, then your ferritin level is going to be very low. Your transferrin saturation level is going to be very low, and your TIBC is going to be very high. Similarly, if you have something like iron overload, where you have too much iron in your body, you just see the opposite picture, where your ferritin and transferrin are very high and your TIBC is very low. So you can see how we can kind of put these together. As I said before, this is part of a constellation in how we look at things and your body as a whole. So the red blood cell count from the full blood count video, that goes hand in hand with iron. So if we think that you're iron deficient because your iron levels are low, we can look at your red cells. And if your red cells are small and maybe you're anemic, we know that you've got iron deficiency anemia. If you're low on iron and you need to boost it, the best way to do that is through diets. Things like supplements are useful if you're very, very deficient in iron, in which case you might want to talk to your doctor about things, but supplements can make you feel a little bit unwell and a little bit constipated, so maybe not the best thing to use to start with. So if you're a little bit low on iron, look at foods. If you eat meat, things like liver, red meat, and meat in general, but definitely red meats, are very good for getting iron levels up over time. If you are vegetarian or vegan, think of things like edamame beans, soybeans, in fact, a lot of kind of beans, pulses, nuts, dried fruits, and fortified cereals. That will help get your levels up. Now, it's worth noting that ferritin, as well as being a fantastic measure of iron stores, is also an inflammatory marker. Now, if you saw our inflammatory marker video, you'll know that if you have an infection or inflammation, certain molecules in your body shoot up as your body mounts a response. ferritin is one of those molecules as well. So if you have an infection or inflammation, then your iron ferritin level becomes a little bit unreliable because the ferritin will also have gone up because of infection or inflammation. Now we validate this by looking at it alongside one of the other inflammatory markers, and if your other inflammatory markers are normal, well, your ferritin is probably going to be a good measure of iron stores. If your inflammatory markers are high and your ferritin level is high, it becomes less reliable. So that's your iron level blood test. I hope it makes sense. Stick with us because next we'll be talking about your vitamin levels. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. It really, really helps. If you want to go into a bit more depth, just go to my website here, and you can also follow me on Instagram and ask any questions you like there. Thank you.